Well, thank you, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here. I want to thank Tom and Sarah and all the folks at the STEMinar office here for the invitation to come speak with you all. I'm a joint appointment at Northwestern and at the Adler Planetarium. I'm an astrophysicist, astronomer by training. I have a degree in physics, but the work that I do and the things that I think about every day are astrophysics and astronomy. And so one of the things that I get to do all the time is I get to come talk to folks like you about all the things that we discover, all the things that we're looking at, all the things that we don't understand about the universe. And so when they were asking me to come talk with y'all, I gave them this long list of things that I could come talk to you about, but they're like, well, we don't know. What do you want to talk about? And so the talk I'm going to give you tonight is called Astronomy Frontiers. And it is a talk that is really a smorgasbord of many different things together about how astronomy is changing and has changed over the course of many, many decades. And so as such, we're going to cover a lot of topics, many of which you've heard about, many of which you may not have. And we'll talk about what we used to know, what we do know, and what the future probably holds in store. Okay? So we'll go through this. And as we're going along, if you have questions, please ask them as we go along. If you're confused, almost certainly someone next to you is confused. And so you should ask the question, and we'll keep everyone on the bus as we go along. But as most of you know, right, this is the astronomy, right? It kind of melts your brain. And so almost certainly what's going to happen is 2 weeks from now, at 2 a.m, you're going to wake up, and you'll have a question. And you'll be like, oh, I wished I had asked Larson that. Okay? Do not wake up your spouse. Kids, don't go down the hall and wake up your parents. They do not want to talk to you about astrophysics at 2 a.m. Okay? But my email address is right there. Okay? slarson@adlerplanetarium.org. It's there for a reason. Okay? Use it. Send me your questions, and we'll see what we can do to help you get some answers. Okay? If you are interested, I do write a public science blog at writescience.wordpress.com. I write a lot about physics. I write a lot about astronomy. I write a lot about science in general there. There's a lot of stuff about different topics there that you may find interesting. I'm also on Twitter. Is anyone live tweeting this event right now? No? Okay, well, if you are, the hashtag for this event is right there at the bottom, chosen by your College of DuPage folks right here. So I've already been using it, so if you go look up that hashtag, you'll see a few tweets there already. Okay, but you're certainly welcome to tweet at me on Twitter. I'll certainly respond to you there as well. Okay? Okay. So let's get started. In the background of this slide is a picture of a galaxy called NGC 1300. It's in the constellation Eridanus, which is the Great Sky River. Tonight at about midnight, if you go out, you will see Orion starting to be high in the sky. Eridanus starts at the knee of Orion and cascades down towards the southern part of the sky. It's not easy to see from the center of the city, but out here in the suburbs, if you're where it's dark enough, you can certainly see it. Pictures like this, 100 years ago, were unheard of. 100 years ago, we knew of things like this in the sky, but we didn't know what they were. This is an example of what's called a barred spiral galaxy. And 100 years ago, we knew of NGC 1300. All the NGC objects, there's about 8,000 of them, were cataloged in the 1800s by William Herschel. But objects like this were then called the spiral nebulae because they looked like every other nebula in the sky. Nebula is the Latin word for cloud. Through a telescope, how many of you have looked through an amateur telescope? Oh, right, that's what I like to see. Okay, lots of you. Things like this just look like little cotton puffs. They just look like little smatterings of light. But large telescopes and the advent of photography has allowed us to realize what these objects really are. And these are, in fact, star systems with billions of stars, hundreds of millions of light years away from the Earth. And that's something that we've only been able to learn by the application of technology, by the creation of the telescope, and by the creation of photography. And that's a common thread that I'm going to come back to over and over again tonight, is that all of the awesome things about the cosmos that we have discovered, we've only been able to discover because we were smart enough to build tools that can understand and detect the cosmos in ways that our bodies are incapable of doing. So the question is, when Galileo, so in 1609, the first telescope used to look at the sky was by Galileo, and the question is, did he also look at the Milky Way? And he did. All the things that you and I take for granted, the moon has craters, the planets are not stars, they're planets, that there's moons around Jupiter, that Venus goes through phases, that Saturn has something weird going on with it, and indeed, that the Milky Way is made of many, many stars, that was discovered by Galileo.
Because so, I've done that. And
mm-hmm. You can. Mirror, yeah. If you just take a pair of binoculars and you look at the Milky Way, it'll look like stars. Absolutely. So Galileo in 1610 wrote a very famous book called Sidereus Nuncius. Okay, and if you go read Sidereus Nuncius, it's written in Latin. Does anyone here read Latin? Okay, I don't either. Okay, so there's English translations. Okay, this guy can read Latin, so you can go check the English translation with him. But you can read about Galileo's first thoughts about all of these things. And this is also part of the story that I think is amazing, right? You and I take this stuff for granted because every time we open a newspaper, every time we open a book, I have a magic device in my pocket that will take me to Wikipedia and show me pictures like this. It's not unusual, but Galileo was seeing it for the first time. And trying to imagine, trying to remember what it was like the very first time you had seen something like the moon through a telescope is hard to do. Okay, if you have a niece or a nephew or a seven-year-old, show them the moon through a telescope the first time and you'll remember that's what it was like for you. And that's what it was like for Galileo for every single thing he looked at. But all because he had the wherewithal to use a piece of technology, a telescope, to look at the sky. Okay? So, let's frame our conversation then. So, we're going to talk about the whole universe in some sense. We're going to talk about a lot of different things, not just focus our attention. The universe as we understand it today is 14.6 billion years old. And we think we know a lot about it, but the more we stare and the more we look, the more we understand that it is awesome and mysterious in ways that we have never ever imagined. Every single day, we answer questions that we've had for hundreds of years, but we replace it with 100 new questions that we don't have any idea what the answers are. And we'll talk about some of those questions today. As an astronomer, your career in astronomy will span maybe 50 years, from the time you're a graduate student to the time they wheel you out of your office, okay? And even in just my lifetime as an astronomer, which is not even close to 50 years yet, the universe has changed dramatically in terms of what we understand and what the frontiers of knowledge are. And so I can only imagine what it's going to be like when I get to the end of my career, okay? But we'll speculate on that today some, okay? And so this is really the question. How much, based on our prior experience, can our understanding change? And the thing that when you take science classes, right, they also make you take philosophy classes, right? And so I took philosophy of science. And the thing that philosophers always point at when they talk about scientists studying the universe is they go back to the early 20th century. And in the early 20th century, it was fashionable in physics to say, physics is dead. There's nothing else to learn. And then we invented relativity and quantum mechanics and modern physics, and we get to the world where we are today. And so one of the amazing things to me is that in my generation of scientists, none of us ever say that. We all know that this is true. We all know that there is more to the universe to discover than what we were taught in school. And so we all know that this is coming, that in 50 years, when I get to the end of my career, there are still going to be unanswered questions, and there will be things that I will never know the answer to, because we'll never get to the answer before I finally kick the bucket, okay? So we'll talk about some of those things today. So let's go to 25 years ago, 1991, okay? So I was in college in 1991. This was about the time I was deciding that I was going to be a physicist. Actually, I decided I was going to be an engineer, because in those days, if you were an engineer, you could fly the space shuttle. And that's what I was going to do. Okay, but I took an astronomy class, and I'm like, oh yeah, this is the stuff I should be doing, because astronomy is awesome. And so I became a physicist. So when I took my first astronomy class, what was the world like? Okay, so the universe as we understood it had in it only one planetary system, the planetary system of the sun. The Earth was, it still is, our home. But in 1991, the Earth and the planets of the sun were the only planets that we knew of. Our inner hearts believed that there were planets elsewhere because Gene Roddenberry and George Lucas had told us there were. But as astronomers, the only planets we knew of were these ones around the sun. And probably the most important point was in 1991, Pluto was still a planet. Okay, so there are perfect examples of how we've gotten dumber over time. Okay, we were pretty smart in 91. Pluto was still a planet. Okay. This was the largest telescope in the world, and it would be until 1993. This is the 5-meter, the 200-inch Hale telescope on Mount Palomar. It is on the mountains between Los Angeles and San Diego. Not the best place in the world to have a telescope because there are a lot of light bulbs in Los Angeles and San Diego. But since 1948, it had been the largest telescope on the planet. If you go visit Palomar, you certainly can. You can see it in a view like this. There's a viewing gallery where you can look through it. You can still observe on it if you're an astronomer. I have observed on the Palomar telescope. Okay, so just for scale, you'll see right there, that's a nitrogen tank on a dolly. So if you imagine a person standing right there at the bottom, that gives you a sense of the scale of the telescope. Okay? Now, today, these telescopes are completely outfitted with cameras. But 25 years before this, before 1991, astronomers still actually used their eyeballs. And on the Hale telescope, there's an observer's cage up here, which you can still go up and look at, although no astronomer has observed up there for a long time. But Edwin Hubble, who's arguably one of the most famous astronomers in American history, used to observe from the cage up there at the top of the Hale telescope. Okay? There's, of course, a telescope named after Hubble. Okay? This is arguably the most influential scientific instrument in history. We just celebrated the 25th anniversary of the launch of the Hubble Space Telescope. Okay? In 1991, it had been in orbit for 1 year. This was before we had fixed it. When we launched Hubble, the mirror had been figured improperly. That's like getting your prescription on your glasses done wrong, and it could not see things nearly as clear as we expected. So we had to figure out how to service it, and indeed we did. We serviced it 5 more times. It's had a 25-year lifetime. I was at a conference last year celebrating Hubble's 25th anniversary. There have been more than 10,000 papers written about the pictures taken with the Hubble Space Telescope. More than any scientific instrument in history, this machine has transformed our view of the cosmos. Okay? And it had just been launched in 1990. This was the most distant object that was ever known. Okay, this is what's called a quasar. Okay, quasar, so in the 60s, when telescopes first started getting very good, and we first started doing complete sky surveys, we started discovering all kinds of things that we had never seen before, and so we made up names for them. Okay, and so this is a kind of object that we had discovered in the 60s that we made up a name for called quasar. Quasar is the, it's not an acronym, but it's the alliteration for what we call a quasi-stellar object. It's an object which looks for all the world like a star, but it's enormously far away. Okay, this object is 12.4 billion light years away, and it emits more energy than any object we had ever seen before. Quasars in 1991, even today, are the most energetic objects known. And in 1991, we had no idea what they were. The question is about the language I just used, which is, I say we don't know what quasars are, and the question is, do you mean we don't know what quasars were? And so we talk about the universe in the present tense, because we don't know what quasars are doing right now, because that information is going to take 12.4 billion years to get from there to me. So I talk about the quasars in the present tense, because that's what I see happening right now. Okay? Okay. But this is part of the difficulty in astronomy, right? Looking back through the universe is looking back in time. And language that you and I use, like we're using right now, is not well suited to talking about the grand mysteries of the cosmos in very precise terms. Because we all associate different meanings with words. And so when I'm a physicist and I say a quasar is, I mean, the data just showed me this yesterday. But when I think about it in the context of a life, which is what we're used to doing, because we think about our own lives, I'm talking about how it was 12.4 billion years ago, right? So the question is, do we know enough about quasars to know what they may become? So we do now, but we did not in 1991. Okay, and I'm not going to tell that whole story, but I may tell you a little bit of it later. So this is actually a good question, right? So I told you this is 12.4 billion light years away. Okay, so if you're not an astronomer, which of course I am, right, this is the flaw of all teachers, I know everything and you don't know everything I know, right? Okay, so let's talk about scales, okay? So the solar system from us to Pluto is 5 hours across at the speed of light from the sun to Pluto, okay? The Milky Way, our own galaxy, is 100,000 years at the speed of light. The closest galaxy to us, called the Andromeda Galaxy, is 2 million years at the speed of light. This is 12.5 billion years. This is far outside of anything close to you and I. It's out past Skokie somewhere. Okay, that's an excellent question, right? Okay, so as I go along, I will try and remember to do this. I will tell you about where things are in our galaxy or outside our galaxy, because that's an important point in all of this story. Okay, everyone else on the bus? Okay. So quasars, very far away. They are the most distant objects known at that time, okay? 12.4 billion years. Okay, this is a supernova remnant in the Milky Way. Okay, the last supernova, which is the explosion of a massive star at the end of its life. The last supernova in the Milky Way was in 1604. That was 6 years before Galileo first used a telescope to look at the sky. There has been no supernova in the Milky Way since the invention of the telescope. That was true 25 years ago, and it's still true today. Astronomers are dying to have a supernova in the Milky Way. Okay, but there hasn't been one. This particular one, you can't see this in a telescope. You can see it in astrophotography. It's a very famous one. This one's called Kepler's supernova. Okay, but in astronomy, the frontier is always on the move, okay? And so if I go just a little bit farther back than 25 years, to 1987, okay, so I was still in K through 12, okay, in 1987, something very important happened in February. Does anyone know what happened? So she asked, is this when the comet hit Jupiter?
Yeah.
So that was 1994. So it was a little bit after that, yeah, okay. So actually, that caused me to build my first telescope that I use in my backyard, because I wanted to watch the comet hit Jupiter, and it was awesome. So what happened in 1987? I don't know what was happening with gravitational waves in 1987. Yeah, so no, that's not what I'm thinking of. That may have happened, but that's not what I'm thinking of, okay? In 1987, in a galaxy nearby to the Milky Way, so not in the Milky Way, but 168,000 light years away. So to the edge of the Milky Way and half again as far, is a galaxy called the Large Magellanic Cloud. And you can't see it from Chicago, but if you go to the southern hemisphere, if you go hang out in Brazil or Australia, you can see it with your naked eye in the sky. Okay? a star exploded. Okay, so this is the closest supernova to Earth known since the invention of the telescope. And it's called Supernova 1987A. So the way we name supernovas is SN means supernova. 1987 is the year. The first one's called A. The second one's called B. Third one's called C. Okay, so you can get the deal. So this is a picture. Luckily, we have a picture of that region of the sky before the supernova. That's the star. And this is the supernova a day after it exploded. When a star reaches the end of its life and it explodes, for a very short period of time, it outshines all the stars in the galaxy put together. When the last supernova in the Milky Way exploded, you could read by it at night, and you could see it during the daytime. They are enormous generators of astronomical energy. Yeah, so it depends on the star, but typical supernovas will rise to full brightness in a day or a week. They will stay bright for a week or a couple weeks, and then they will slowly fade away. Okay? Other questions? Okay? So this had astronomers enormously excited. There were astronomers all over the planet who were taking flights to Australia because while they were on the flight, they could look out the window and see the supernova. Okay? But it was in the southern sky, and so we had to study these with our telescopes that could see those parts of the southern sky. Okay? But this is the only supernova that's happened close, and it's still not even in our own galaxy. So we'd still like to see one up close. But it's close enough that we could do something remarkable. Okay? And so 25 years ago, oh, this is why we're interested in supernovas. Okay? I forgot to tell you this. Okay? So all stars die, right? You've all probably heard Carl Sagan, that's who I grew up listening to, or Neil deGrasse Tyson say, we're all made of star stuff, right? And the reason is because stars, when they go through their lives, they have one job. They get up in the morning, and they take hydrogen, and they turn it into helium. And the next morning, they get up, and they turn hydrogen into helium. And the next morning, they get up, and they turn hydrogen into helium. And they do that for millions and millions of years. And when they get to the end of their life, they die in this spectacular explosion. And that explosion creates all the elements that make up you and me. They're made in the explosions of stars. So when you look around you, everything you see, from planets to rocks to kangaroos, oak trees, cheeseburgers, iPhones, Yugos, Lego bricks, all of those things are made from the ashes of stars. So if I'm trying to understand all of this stuff on Earth and where it came from, the story begins with what's going on with the stars. So this is why we want to see supernovas. We want to know, where does all this stuff come from? How come it occurs in the proportions it does? Does the stuff that leads to the stuff we see here on Earth occur all the time? We can only learn those answers by watching stars explode. So you can only cook up to iron in the star. Beyond iron, you have to get from the supernova. Okay? Okay. Okay. So in the supernova, what happens is all of the material in the star gets combined in these very intense nuclear processes. And one of those processes takes a proton, and it smashes together with an electron, and it makes a particle called a neutron. This ultimately leads to the stellar skeleton that's left behind, either a black hole or something we call the neutron star. But it also produces a very energetic subatomic particle called a neutrino. The neutrino was something that was proposed in the 1930s. It was a theoretical construct. It wasn't detected in the lab until the 40s. But we had always known that they should be produced in massive quantities when stars explode. Okay, and so in 1987, there was a very large detector in a mine in Japan called the Super K detector in the Kamioka mine. It's a gigantic tank of water. Okay, you see some scientists floating around in a dinghy here. Okay, and surrounding the whole tank are all of these cameras. Okay, and when the scientists aren't in there, when neutrinos go through the water, they make little flashes of light that the cameras pick up. And at the moment of supernova 1987A, 24 neutrinos were detected. Out of a total of about 10 to the 57 that should have been generated in the supernova explosion. Okay, so now what's 10 to the 57 mean? Okay, 10 to the 57 is 1 followed by 57 zeros. So that's what? There's a trillion, a trillion, a trillion, a trillion, a trillion. So that's a trillion, 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 trillion neutrinos. And we saw 24 of them. Okay? This is the beginning, the very beginning of being able to do astronomy without light. 25 years ago was the beginning of what we call precision astronomy. I can detect 24 neutrinos from 10 to the 57 neutrinos and be confident that they came from an astronomical event. That was awesome. And to tell you how awesome, I Googled, I went to our database of papers, and I looked for papers that had the word neutrino and supernova 1987A in the title together. Okay, so there's 24 neutrinos. Does anyone want to guess how many papers I found? 11,000. We wrote 11,000 papers about 24 neutrinos. That's how awesome that discovery is. It is fundamentally a different way of watching stars explode. So the question is about the mass of the neutrino. There is good evidence that the neutrinos are massive. We do not know what their masses are. We only know that their masses are different from each other. This is an ongoing question, and, you know, 25 years from now, we should know the answer. Okay? Okay. That's something we've only known for about 5 or 6 years now. So, okay. Okay? So this was the beginning of what we call precision astronomy. So, let's fast forward to today. Okay? It's 2016. The world should be a different place. And indeed it is. Much has changed just in my lifetime, since I was a student till today, when I'm a professor. All that stuff that I got taught, I have to unlearn. I have to teach the students new stuff, because that dinosaur astronomy, they don't need to know. They want to know what's going on today. Well, here's an example. We fixed Hubble. And so then we started to do awesome things with Hubble. And multiple times now, we have taken Hubble, and we have found a spot on the sky that we thought was completely empty. And when I say completely empty, I mean we have never seen anything in any photograph on that part of the sky ever. And we take the Hubble, and we point it at that part of the sky for 10 days. Okay? And Hubble's field of view is about the size of the eye on a dime if you hold the dime out at arm's length. Okay? That's the size of the spot on the sky that Hubble's looking at. And what do you think we see if we stare at the same spot in the sky with Hubble for 10 days? We see galaxies. Lots and lots of galaxies. This is called the Hubble Ultra Deep Field. Every time we've made a deep field image with the Hubble, we see something not unlike this. Every object, virtually, that you see in this image is a galaxy. So, if I take the size of this part of the sky, I count how many galaxies I see, I imagine covering the whole sky with spots that big, I can tell you there are probably about 600 billion galaxies in all the cosmos. So 2 days ago, they have done a reanalysis of this. Okay, they have started thinking about what Hubble can't do, what you could do if you could look longer. They've compared to other deep fields, and this number should be about 2 trillion, we think. Okay, it could be larger. Okay. Now, this is a big number. And the problem with big numbers is that we say, I'm like, oh yeah, billion galaxies, no problem. Okay? 2 million light years away, no problem. 1 billion light years away, no problem, right? We talk about these numbers every day in such drab terms that we forget how enormous they really are. There are only 400 billion stars in the Milky Way. So there are more galaxies in the universe than there are stars in the Milky Way. But I'm still like, oh yeah, there's only 400 billion stars in the galaxy, right? The only time any of us actually encounter numbers this large is when we talk about the national budget. Right?
Yes.
Yeah, and even then we're like, oh yeah, it's $1 trillion. Okay? These numbers are huge. Okay? I have a 10-year-old. She's beyond this phase now, but when she was about this guy's age right here, she liked to count. And she tried to count to 1 million once. Okay? It doesn't go very quick, right? These numbers are huge. And it's important to not forget those. But it's an important thing to remember because we're capable of working with these numbers and thinking about them. We're just incapable of remembering exactly how ginormous they are. So, okay. Today, we know that black holes power the quasars. At the heart of every quasar is a supermassive black hole. Not the mass of the sun, not 10 times the mass of the sun, but billions of times the mass of the sun. If you took 1 billion stars in the Milky Way galaxy and could compress them together into a single black hole, you would get the kind of black hole that we have at the center of a quasar. People know that these are also harbored in the hearts of many galaxies. And someone asked earlier, do we know what quasars evolve into? Well, we think they evolve into ordinary, what we call active galaxies today. How do we know that? Because Hubble took pictures of many, many quasars. And the power of that piece of technology is that it showed us, not only do we see the star-like object, the quasi-stellar object, but we see the galaxy surrounding it. We know that the quasars are actually galaxies very early in their lives, powered by these massive, massive black holes. What we don't know is where those black holes came from, and we still don't know. So this is similar to the earlier question, which is, this isn't happening in real time. All of these pictures were generated 12 billion years ago, and that light has been traveling across the cosmos till it gets to us today. Okay, but this story that the quasars become galaxies and active galaxies that we see today is because I don't see any quasars close to us, but I do see active galaxies close to us, and the active galaxies are active because they have big black holes in them. Okay, so we think the quasars become the active galaxies, and right, so there's this long chain. I often liken it to, you know, none of you know every other person in this room. But if I pulled 10 of us out of the audience here and put us up here in the front, you could almost certainly put us all in age order. Because you've seen enough people and you know enough of what their characteristics are that you can figure out what the right age is. This is the same thing that we have going on in astronomy. We've seen enough galaxies now that we think we know enough about the connections between them that we can put them in age order. Okay. Black holes are actually very common today. When I was in school, we didn't actually know, or you couldn't get an astronomer to commit to the idea that black holes were real. They were predictions from general relativity. We knew what their effects would be. We certainly knew what they would do if something strayed too close to them or if they were orbiting around the star. But we hadn't collected enough pictures and enough information with our telescopes to convince us that they were actually an important part of astrophysics. But today, 25 years later, there's hardly an astronomer who doesn't believe that they're a part of astrophysics. We need them to explain high-energy X-ray stars. We need them to explain quasars. We need them to explain what we see going on in the center of our own Milky Way galaxy. Black holes are part of the standard literature of astronomy in just 25 short years. The most distant thing we've seen in the universe is this. This is called the cosmic microwave background. This is the light that the universe emitted at the moment that all the atoms were created at the beginning of the cosmos. 400,000 years after the Big Bang, the universe was a turbulent cosmic soup of energy that was too hot and too dense for atoms to hold together. Every time an atom tried to form, it crashed into another atom and broke apart. But at about 400 years, the universe had expanded enough that the atoms were far enough apart that when they formed, they didn't collide into a friend, and they didn't break apart. And at the moment that happened, the cosmic soup evaporated, and all the light that was released became what we call the cosmic microwave background. It is a faint glow of microwave light that comes to us from every direction on the sky. It is very nearly uniform. But the picture that you see here shows the differences in how bright the microwaves are in different directions in the sky. The difference between the dark blue spot and the dark red spot is a difference of about 1 in 100,000, or 1 in 1,000,000. Okay? Very, very tiny difference. But it's those very small differences that we think, we don't know, we still think, lead to all the structure in the cosmos that we see today, the galaxies and the cosmic network of superclusters. So the question is now that we think there's more galaxies, does that change our understanding of the amount of matter and our understanding of the evolution of the universe? And I would say the answer is no, because the number of galaxies that have been, it's only been increased by about a factor of 2, and we understand the content of the universe much more accurately than that. And I'll tell you about that in a minute. Okay? Okay. The largest telescopes effectively today are these. These are the twin Keck telescopes in Hawaii. They are both 10 meters across. They often work in concert with each other. We take the light from the two telescopes at the same time, and we combine them to make a single image. That's called an interferometer. Okay, and today, for the moment, Keck is still the largest effective telescope that we have. There are, however, 18 telescopes on the planet larger than the Hale telescope. So in 25 years, we've produced 18 new telescopes that are bigger than the one telescope that was the largest in the world for almost 70 years. So the question is, does the Keck telescope act like a pair of eyes? And that's absolutely true. The reason we have two telescopes together is because we want to see really tiny, tiny details. And the way you see really tiny details is you triangulate with your eyes, right? You look from two different directions. And the Keck basically does that this way. Okay? Okay. Now, we talked about how everything that we see in the universe comes from supernovas. Okay, the 92 naturally occurring elements, all the way up through uranium, are naturally produced in supernova explosions. But what we've discovered in the last 25 years is that they only make up 4% of everything in the cosmos. Stuff like you and me and rocks and kangaroos and the Earth and the Sun and Jupiter and Pluto, those are made out of atoms. Those are made out of the stuff that's made in supernovas. And that's only 4% of everything that's in the universe. 23% of the universe is something that we call dark matter. It was actually discovered in 1933 by a guy named Fritz Zwicky, who always discovered things 30 years before everyone else realized it was important. Okay. But in the 1960s, an astronomer named Vera Rubin discovered that every galaxy is full of this stuff that we call dark matter. And it makes up 23% of the universe. It's dark. It doesn't emit any light. It exerts gravitational influence on everything else in the cosmos. It makes galaxies rotate faster than we think they should have. I've just told you everything that we know about dark matter. And people write PhD theses about this stuff. Okay? We know a lot about what it's not. but we don't know anything about what it is other than this number. About 20 years ago now, okay, 1998, so that I can't do that right, about 15 years ago now, okay, we discovered that 73% of the universe is made out of some mysterious something that we call dark energy that's making the universe expand faster than we ever expected it should have. It makes supernova explosions in other galaxies that are millions of light years away from the Earth appear farther away than they really are. I've just told you everything that we know about dark energy. And people still write PhD theses about this stuff. Okay? But all of it together is what makes up the cosmos. So 25 years ago, we thought we knew what the cosmos was made out of. We knew there was this dark matter stuff. Okay? But today, we've discovered that we really only know what 4% of it is. 90%, 96% of everything is completely unknown to us other than the fact that it exists. We are working hard to figure it out. We're very confused. Okay? It's unclear what the answers are going to be. So the question is this stuff in the black hole? There's probably stuff like this in the black holes, but the black holes are not the source of dark matter or dark energy. Okay? We can do tests to show that. Okay? That's an interesting question. For a long time, we thought maybe the dark matter was black holes, but there are other things we should see happening, like they should affect the orbits of planets, or they should go through the Earth now and then, or who knows what. Yeah, so the question is, do black holes suck in dark matter? Absolutely, because black holes exert gravitational influence on the things around them, and the thing we know about dark matter is it interacts with everything through gravity. So it must. Whatever it is, it must. Unless it has some odd gravitational property, we don't know. But as near as we can tell, it doesn't. Okay, one more. You can mathematically talk about anything you want to. We know what the existence of negative mass would do. We have never seen any astrophysical evidence for it ever. Okay? Okay. Pluto, sadly, is no longer a planet.
Says you.
Yeah. Okay, let's take an informal poll here. Pluto is a planet? Pluto is not a planet. Oh, you poor brainwashed people. Okay, well, we will talk about that at some other talk at some other time. I have an opinion, but it's not. But this is actually an important point, right? People often ask, well, why? Right? Those of us who are emotional about this, I'm not emotional about this, but people, why isn't Pluto a planet? And the reason is because in the last 25 years, we've discovered that we don't actually know what we mean when we say the word planet. We don't, right? As scientists, we've discovered we don't know what we actually mean. And so part of the whole process of coming to grips with what do we mean by the word planet means that we had to demote Pluto. So we have something to argue about. Okay? And the thing that's causing this is that as of yesterday, we know of 3,397 planets around other stars. 573 stars are known to have more than one planet. There are 4,670 stars that we think may have planets that we haven't checked up on yet. We live in an era where we have emerged from the ignorance of not knowing whether or not there are stars around other planets. And it's challenging our understanding of what it means to be a planet. Because we thought planetary systems were just like what we see here on Earth. And let me tell you, what we see here around the sun is not what we see going around other stars. We see stars with planets the size of Jupiter going around their star once every 10 days, closer to their star than Mercury is to our sun. We have no idea how to make a planet like that. We are looking for a planet 10 times the size of Earth out past Pluto because we've seen evidence that it might be there and we have no idea how to get it there. Our ideas about what it means to be planets are changing. which is why we had to demote Pluto, because we have to have something to argue about. Okay? But you and I finally live today when we know there are planets around other stars. Yeah, so this, actually, I should have told you about this picture. So this is a picture from the Kepler project, okay? And the way Kepler looks for planets is it looks for the planet to pass in front of the star. Okay, that's called a transit. It's basically an eclipse. And so this gives you a sense of the sizes of some of the planets that we've detected, right? So planets like this, these are Jupiter-sized planets. Okay, the little tiny dots, right, that one, those are like Earth-sized planets.
These are actually stars.
These are actually stars with the size of their planets in front of them, yeah. Okay? Precision astronomy is continuing. Today, so this is what I actually work on. I work on a field called gravitational wave astronomy. I'm a member of the team that works on what's called LIGO, the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory. We have two of these, one in Livingston, Louisiana, and one in Hanford, Washington. We are looking at the universe not with light, but with gravity itself. And that's an awesome thing to be able to do. Because there are objects in the universe, some of which we've talked about today, black holes, dark matter, that don't emit light at all. And so we've built an instrument that's capable of detecting the gravitational signals from the gravity of distant objects. And 25 years ago, we were drawing up the blueprints to build LIGO. Today, right now as I'm speaking to you, we are just more than 1 year past the very first detection ever of gravitational waves from space. The signal we're looking for is a stretching of the shape of space and time. That instrument that I showed you, LIGO, okay? From the corner building here to the end of LIGO, it goes two directions, it's a big L shape. We are shining lasers back and forth looking for the stretching of those arms by gravity. Okay, and the stretching caused along those arms is very tiny. It's equivalent to if I took the distance between us and Alpha Centauri, which is the closest star to the sun. Alpha Centauri is 4.3 years away, traveling at the speed of light. If I change that distance by the width of a human hair, LIGO could detect it. Okay? So, what did we see? We saw two black holes merging. One of the black holes was 29 times the mass of the sun. So, it's 20 times more massive than everything in our entire solar system. And if I turned it into a black hole, it would sit inside the southern end of Lake Michigan. That's how small it would be. And its companion was 36 times the mass of the sun, so just a little bit bigger than the southern end of Lake Michigan. We saw them going around each other during about the last 10 orbits of their lives. They collided at half the speed of light, and they merged to form a new 62 solar mass black hole. And all of this happened 1.3 billion light years away. We have detected the gravitational signal from two black holes from 1.3 billion light years away. This is precision astronomy in the modern era. Just a sec, let me show you guys the data and then I'll take a question. Okay? So this is what the data looks like. This is not astronomy like it was 25 years ago. 25 years ago, and indeed for the 25 years since, we look at pictures through the eyes of Hubble. But the future of astronomy, with high-precision instruments like the neutrino detectors or like LIGO, is about looking at the universe in ways that your body is not designed to sense. And so our data doesn't look even remotely familiar to any of us, because none of us has a gravitational wave detector built into our elbow. Hubble is just a big eyeball. It does what your eye does. It takes a picture and it makes an image. But LIGO does something different. And so the data doesn't look familiar. But the data can be illustrated in a way that's capable of you actually sensing. And that's because these are waves okay, these signals that we get, and those of you who remember your physics class know that waves are universal. Waves are just mathematical representations of data. And in particular, these waves mathematically look exactly the same to us on paper as sound waves. So your smartphone has a whole bunch of wiggles on it, just like this. And when it pushes those wiggles out through the headphone jack, you get Katy Perry, or Led Zeppelin, or Glenn Miller Band, or whatever it is you listen to. But if I stole your smartphone, and I replaced your Katy Perry with these wiggles, you'd hear the LIGO data instead. So do you want to hear the LIGO data?
Hear it.
You want to hear it. Okay, do you want to hear it? Okay, so I'm going to play it. And what this is a movie. Okay, and you'll notice how long it is. It goes from half a second to 1 second. So the total signal we saw lasted half a second. Okay? And when it plays on this side, it's going to be like, that's static. It's like static on your radio, static on your TV set. And that's what LIGO observes all the time when there's not a gravitational wave signal. But when the black holes merge, when that data passes through LIGO, you'll hear what we call the chirp. It'll go whoop, and then it's over, and that's it. And we just happened to be listening at the right time to catch it.
Somebody got awfully lucky.
Well, these things are happening all the time, so maybe we didn't get lucky. We'll know, okay? Okay, so I'm going to play it. It'll play through the first time. It'll kind of sound like a heartbeat. That's the actual data. The second time, we push it up the piano about 2 octaves, okay, so that it's a little bit higher pitched and easier for your ear to hear. Okay? Thump. Okay? Now, the black holes don't make sound, right? But I can take the data and provide it to you in a way that your senses can understand. And while I can look at these signals, I've been staring at these for 15 years, right? I look at that and I'm like, oh my gosh, we just saw 2 black holes, okay? If I play the sounds, every single one of you is capable of determining that they're black holes because your ears have enough capability and enough fidelity to recognize different sounds. That's how you know my voice is different than your neighbor's voice. And if I play black holes, they sound different than neutron stars. If I play spinning black holes from non-spinning black holes, they sound different. And your ear is perfectly capable of sensing that. Okay, so different objects sound different. And so I'm going to push that off right till the very end because I'm going to play 2 other sounds for you so you can hear. Okay? Okay, so if you be patient, then we'll do it. Right there. So the question is, how fast do gravitational waves travel? General relativity predicts that they travel at the speed of light, and that's something we can and have tested, and they travel at the speed of light. Okay? Now, the first tests aren't the greatest tests. We will do more tests, but we need more data, and we need higher quality data, which is, you know, what's happening now as we go on. So, but as near as we can tell, they travel just like general relativity predicts. Okay? So not the same day. So we have this is complicated. We have 2 confirmed signals, okay? And the other one I have in another talk I can play for you afterwards if you want to hear it. Okay, this was the first one. The second one happened, so this one happened in September. The second one happened in December. There was another one we saw in October, but it was what we call marginal. So it's like if you and I were sitting in here and you thought you heard someone whispering in the back of the room, but you weren't quite sure what they said, right? That's a marginal detection. You think they said something, but you weren't quite sure. So we saw a signal. We think it was a signal, but it's not strong enough to be sure. Okay? Okay. Yeah, well, you know. But LIGO, this was the very first time we had turned LIGO on in its advanced configuration. Okay? And we saw these 2 signals that were absolutely spectacular events. And now we've turned it off. And we've been, you know, patching leaks and putting baling twine and duct tape where we need it, turning up the laser power, And just this week, actually, we should have turned on again. And so we're going through a little bit of upscaling, and about the end of the month, we'll be in full observing again. And so what that means is if these things are common, we should be seeing things more and more often as time goes on. Yeah. So the question is, did gravitational waves prove something, right? So general relativity, which is Einstein's description for the way gravity works, which has been confirmed by zillions of other experiments, this was one of the last things that it predicted that we had to measure, right? 100 years ago, Einstein said, we should be able to detect gravitational waves. He also said, this will be technically impossible. No one will ever be able to do this. But you and I live in the future, and we have supercomputers and lasers, and we can do what Einstein thought was impossible, and indeed we have. So, okay? Let me take one more, and then I'm going to finish off. So here's the question. Have we photographed black holes, right? So black holes, by definition, are objects which do not emit light. So anytime you hear someone talk about observing black holes or photographing a system with a black hole, they're photographing the black hole's influence on something else. Tearing apart a star, tearing apart a gas cloud, something. LIGO detected the black holes themselves. There was no light associated with this event. What we observed with LIGO was the black hole and another black hole, a second black hole. So yeah, two black holes.
But that picture just represented.
Yeah, so this picture that I showed, this is a movie of the event generated on a computer. Yeah, this is what you would have seen if you were the same distance from those black holes that the Earth is, but you can't see this, right? What you see going on here in the background, right, is the light from all those stars in the background is trying to go this way, but the gravity from the black holes is so intense is that it's bending its pathway and distorting the view of the stars.
LIGO is on the outer perimeter.
No, LIGO is 1.3 billion years from this. Yeah, the waves are being generated on the scale of the orbit of the black holes, absolutely. Yeah, they're not coming from inside the black hole. They're coming from outside. Because nothing can get away from a black hole. If you're inside the black hole, you cannot get out. That means if you're light, if you're gravitational waves, if you're astronomy students, lawyers, whatever. If you're inside the black hole, you can't get out. The waves are coming from the outside, absolutely. Okay, last one, and then I'm going to go on. So the question is, how did the black holes get to be that close together? That is one of the big mysteries of these two black holes. Okay, first of all, we don't know how to make black holes this size. We don't know how to make black holes that are 30 times the mass of the sun, and we don't know how to get them that close together at this time in the universe's age. So we're working on it. There are mysteries to be solved even today. Okay, let's jump to the future, and then we'll tie it off, and I'm happy to take lots of questions afterwards. So in 2041, I can't do that math in my head. I don't know how old I'll be. Okay, but it'll be near the end of my career in astronomy. Okay. Tom and I will be in the old folks' home, and y'all will be smuggling tacos into us, okay? In 2041, not only will we know about planets around other stars, but we will have detected planets that are exactly the same size as the Earth, and we will have detected whether or not they have atmospheres and what the chemical content of those atmospheres are. And those of us who are interested in the question of life on other worlds, this is one of the only ways we know how to get at this question. We know that life on Earth leaves particular chemical signatures in our atmosphere. And so we're going to look for those signatures in the atmospheres of other planets. And as our telescopes get bigger, we should be able to do that. Computers and computer simulation are going to be so, so important in the future. When I was first starting in astronomy, computers were first becoming prominent. That's because they had finally gotten to the point where they could sit on your desktop and be carried around in your hand, as opposed to filling a room the size of the room in here. Okay? But more and more, we've come to rely on them to process the enormous amounts of data that we collect, but also to help us understand what kinds of physics is important inside the astrophysical systems that we're looking at. Here are several examples that you see. This one here that's labeled entire galaxies, that's a simulation from my group. One of the things that we're interested in is how do stars live and die over the entire history of the Milky Way galaxy? What does the stellar graveyard of the Milky Way look like? Other colleagues of mine simulate the merger of black holes, like the one that we just saw from LIGO. Other colleagues of mine are trying to understand the deaths of stars. How do they explode and how do they make all of the stuff that becomes me and you? All of this is at the forefront of modern computing technology. It was impossible to do 25 years ago. It's barely possible to do today, although not as accurately as we would like. 25 years from now, you'll be able to do it on your iPhone, probably, right? Telescopes are getting bigger all the time. This particular telescope is called the Giant Magellan Telescope. It is a consortium of universities. Each telescope in the center of the Giant Magellan Telescope is as large as the largest telescopes today. The entire telescope will be something like 30 meters across from one side to the other. Okay. It is being built in Chile. We have, because it's near the equator, the question is why in Chile? It's high in the mountains and it's near the equator, so we can see lots of the southern sky and lots of the northern sky, right? You don't want to miss those supernovas, right? Yeah, okay. We have imagined, although they are probably economically unfeasible, even larger telescopes, this telescope is 100 meters across side to side. See the car? It's so big that we can't rotate the building. We just slide the building off of it. Okay. Does anyone know what this telescope's called? It's called OWL, the overwhelmingly large telescope. Okay. I would love to see such a telescope built. I don't think it's economically feasible. But you know, those big numbers, $1 trillion. Yeah, it's $1 trillion. We'll see. I'm willing to bet a bag of jelly donuts and a Dr. Pepper to anyone who wants to bet me that we still will not know what dark matter and dark energy is 25 years from now. Now, those of you who have neighbors who work at Fermilab, they will almost certainly take me up on that bet, but trust me, I'm going to win that bet. Okay. But I'm pretty sure we still won't know. It is a continuing conundrum. Zwicky discovered dark matter in 1930. We are rapidly approaching the century mark on the discovery of dark matter, and we still don't have any idea what it is. Okay, we know lots of things of what it's not. We thought we've been zeroing in on the idea that it's some unknown subatomic particle, but the experiments that are looking for those unknown subatomic particles are starting to run out of space to look for things, and so we may not know. WIMPs have not been ruled out. They are getting very, in my estimation, my professional estimation as a physicist, my colleagues will disagree with you and other colleagues will agree with me, but it's getting very tight. It's getting harder and harder to understand what the WIMP could be. And that has a lot to do with the fact that our friends at the Large Hadron Collider, the LHC, are not seeing new physics that is beyond the physics that we currently understand. And so we're going to have to go back to the drawing table here pretty soon to come up with some new ideas. Okay? It may still be WIMPs, just some way we haven't thought about them. But the current ideas, they're getting squeezed very, very tightly. And there are many of us who are starting to worry about that. Okay? That doesn't mean we're right. We could be wrong. We have to have things to argue about in science, right? That's why we demoted Pluto. So. Relativity?
Yes,
general relativity does not predict the existence of dark matter or dark energy. It does not predict what matter in the universe is. It only predicts what matter does to the universe. Okay? The content of the universe, that's a completely separate question. Okay? In 25 years, when I retire, we will have flown an interferometer in space. This is just like the LIGO detector, except instead of building it on the ground and having long tubes between them, we're going to fly three spacecraft. And we're going to shoot lasers between the spacecraft, and we'll be able to detect gravitational waves in outer space. The difference between LIGO and LISA is that LIGO is 4 kilometers across the observatory. LISA is 1 million times larger. 5 million kilometers, 30 times the separation between the Earth and the Moon from one spacecraft to the other. So this picture is not to scale. Okay? Now, some gentleman earlier asked me, what do other things sound like? Okay? So one of the things that Lisa will see that LIGO cannot is big black holes merging to form big black holes. LIGO saw a 30 plus a 30. Lisa will see a million plus a million. Lisa will see 10,000 plus a million. And that will tell us something about how those big black holes grow in the centers of galaxies. The question is, why does LIGO see the smaller ones, and why does Lisa see the bigger ones? It has to do with the size of the waves. So the size of the waves you can see are about the size of your instrument. And the small black holes can get close together because they're small, so they make really tightly spaced waves. Okay? So let me play a couple sounds for Lisa, and then we'll call it a night, and I'll just take questions for the rest of the night. So the first thing that I heard you listen to was the chirp of a 29 solar mass black hole falling into a 36 solar mass black hole. That's real data. That was the actual data from LIGO. We haven't flown Lisa yet, so all we can do is simulate the signals that we're going to see. So that's what I've done here. And I'm going to play the signal for you. I'm going to play it two times. Okay, I can't do that with LIGO yet because we only made two detections. Okay, but I'm going to play two signals for you because I want you to hear that the astrophysical information is different. And so I'm going to throw a 10 solar mass black hole into a 10,000 solar mass black hole. And the first time I do it, the orbits are going to be perfect circles that just shrink and shrink and shrink and shrink until the black holes merge. And the second time I do it, the orbits are going to be long ovals. And what you'll hear is that the waves sound different. And the whole point in that exercise is that you can tell the difference because the waves look different. If I detect one wave, it means I have circular orbits. If I detect the other wave, it means I have oval orbits. And those mean different things about where the black holes come from. This is what precision astronomy is going to be in 25 years. Okay, so let's play that first one. Lisa will observe these for a whole year, so this is just the end of it. Okay? It chirped, just like the LIGO chirp, but it sounds different because the black holes are bigger. I could see it for more than half a second because the black holes are bigger. Okay? Here's the next one. Sounds like your car, right? I hope not. So it chirped again. So what's going on there, right? When the black holes are far apart, their gravity between each other is not strong, and so it's quiet. And when they get close together, the gravitational interaction is very strong, and you get one of those clunks. And then they're far apart, and they're close, and they clunk. And they're far apart, and they're close, and they clunk. And as time goes on, it shrinks that oval until they're just close together, and it starts to sound a lot like the last one. Okay? We can tell that from the gravitational wave data. Okay, so this is what living on the frontier is like, right? We're all learning new things every single day. The stuff we teach you in astronomy class is stuff that we're confident in. It's stuff that we've learned and confirmed over decades of observations. But every single day, we're discovering brand new things that we had no idea about before. There is an enormous body of knowledge of things that we know about, but things that we don't have any idea how to explain why or how they happen. That's what modern astronomy is all about. And the things that will be discovered in your lifetime, or in the rest of our lifetimes, are things that we really haven't even imagined yet. 25 years ago, we had no idea there was anything called dark energy. And today, it's a central part of modern astronomy. That's the way it goes in astronomy today. Okay? So, I'd like to leave you with things to do. Okay, here are three very nice books if you'd like to go read some more. Okay, those of you who've been asking me lots of questions about cosmology, this is a very nice book by Marsha Bartusiak called The Day We Discovered the Universe. It is about Hubble and the era of when we were discovering the galaxies and when we were discovering that the universe was expanding and about the realization that the universe is much larger than we ever imagined it to be. This is a DK book from Smithsonian that I like very much. It's basically a giant coffee table book. It has 2 pages on everything in astronomy. So if you're interested in quasars, there's 2 pages on quasars. If you're interested in asteroids, there's 2 pages in asteroids. It's very pretty. It's got lots of pretty pictures. I think it's written very nicely, and it's easy to read. This book by Chet Ramo is really geared towards amateur astronomers. It's called 365 Starry Nights. Every night of the year, it has something for you to go outside and look up and see. It's very nice because it tells you about something you can see yourself, some way for you to directly interface with the cosmos, but it also tells you a little bit of science along the way. Okay, so it's a very nice book. Okay, and then I always recommend people go watch, if you haven't seen it in a long time, you should go watch it again, Powers of 10. It's a very famous movie made by the Ames brothers. It's famous for starting in Grant Park here in Chicago, okay? And it's called Powers of 10. It zooms out through the universe to the largest scales of the universe we can imagine, and then it zooms in to the inner universe to the scale of the subatomic particles. Okay, it's a very nice movie. It's very good to kind of melt your brain and help you think about those big, gigantic numbers that we were just talking about. So, okay? You can find this on YouTube now, okay? Okay, and if you can't, your library almost certainly has a copy of it on VHS somewhere. You can probably buy it on Amazon, yeah, okay? Okay, but if you just go to YouTube and you Google Power of 10 Eames, it'll come up. Okay? Okay, so I'm going to quit there and say thank you so much for your attention, and I'm certainly happy to take some more questions for 10 minutes or so if folks want to have some. This is a great question. Why are there so few supernova? So, if you go, right, if you're hanging out Barnes & Noble and you see an astronomer and you ask them, how many supernovas should there be? They will tell you that a galaxy like the Milky Way should have a supernova once every 50 years. Okay, so how do I know that number? Well, humans only live for 100 years. And there hasn't been a supernova in the Milky Way for 400 years. So how do I know a galaxy like the Milky Way should have a supernova once every 50 years? Well, I can see hundreds of thousands of galaxies in my telescope. And if I just watch all hundreds of thousands of them, and I count how many supernovas I see, and I divide by the number of galaxies, I get that it should be about once per 50 years. So the question becomes, why hasn't there been one in the Milky Way? And there's probably a couple of answers to that. One is, this is statistics, right? We're dying to have a supernova. We would love to have a supernova. But there hasn't been one in one per 50 years in the Milky Way in like 8 times the amount of time we talked. But if you go flip a coin 10 times, there's a good chance you're going to flip 4 heads in a row. That's just the way statistics works. It's not going to be heads, then tails, and then heads, and tails. It's just sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. If we had gone 1,000 years or 10,000 years without a supernova, then we'd be a little bit worried that there's something weird about the Milky Way. Okay, but we're not there yet, right? So this has led to some interesting speculation, and one of the speculations is that, well, maybe there have been supernovas in the Milky Way, we just haven't noticed them. And the one possibility for that is that when you look at the Milky Way, how many of you have seen the Milky Way? Okay, that's good, okay, not everyone has. It's this diffuse band of light that stretches across the sky when you're out away from the city. And if you notice, that band of light has a dark center to it. Okay, that dark center is gas and dust in the galaxy blocking the light of stars from behind us. And it has been speculated, although I would say we don't all agree, that maybe supernovas are happening in the Milky Way, they're just obscured behind the gas and dust. Okay, that has yet to be decided, but there have been people who have been speculative that that is true. So we'll see. So in that pie chart, right, that was a very coarse pie chart. Okay, it includes all of the matter and all of the dark matter and all of the dark energy in the rough proportions that we think they have. Okay, things like the light are actually an interesting question. There's not enough light to be substantial on the scale of dark energy or dark matter. But the question of how much light there is in the universe is one that astronomers worry about. And the reason is because the amount of matter in the universe is actually very confusing to us. Because if we think about the universe being created and evolving through the Big Bang, it seems to us, based on what we understand about atomic physics and subatomic physics and the standard model and all that particle physics stuff, that there should have been precisely the same amount of matter as there is antimatter. And that's not true, because we see no antimatter, at least not in large quantities. We can make it in the lab, but it's not just floating around. And we see lots of ordinary matter. And so one of the things that astronomers speculate about is all of the light probably came from the destruction of all the antimatter in the early universe by combining it with matter that used to be there. So matter and antimatter collide, they annihilate each other and become light. And so there's this concerted effort to try and figure out how much light is there, because we think it might be a part of the story about telling us where all the antimatter went. Okay? So we don't know, right, is really the question. It's not enough to, you know, make an influence the way dark energy is, but we don't know what the deal is. Okay? So it's good that you're disconnected on that. When you're tired of, you know, being a lawyer or whatever you are, you can come back to graduate school and you and I will talk about that. So yes, that's the question. Why is that true?
That proportion would have to be much stronger for regular matter than antimatter.
So we call that the baryon asymmetry in the universe, if you want to go look that up. And we don't know why it happens. But what is antimatter? So matter and antimatter are both stuff that belongs in that 4% of the pie. Okay, and if I have a piece of matter and a piece of antimatter that are correlated with each other, so a proton, that's the thing that makes up the atoms in the middle of you, okay, and an antiproton, what's different about them? Okay, they're exactly the same size, they weigh exactly the same amount, they're the same mass. The only thing different between them is that their electric charge is different. Okay, now, why? That's a subtle and interesting question. But by definition, that's what it is. It's a particle that has these quantum charges, as we call them, flipped. Okay? Now, this was something that was completely speculative. Physicists predicted it mathematically, but we can go in the lab and we can make this stuff, right? So we know it can exist, which is why it generates all these weird questions, right? Is why isn't it common in the universe like everything else? So what am I? Okay, so I am a doppelganger. I have a PhD in physics. My research is in astronomy or astrophysics, depending on what you want to call it. So when I hang out with my physics friends, they think I'm an astronomer, and they ask me all kinds of astronomy questions. And when I hang out with my astronomy friends, they think I'm a physicist, and they ask me all kinds of physics questions. So I get the best of both worlds, and I put on whichever hat suits me the most. When I ride on airplanes, I sit down, and the people next to me say, "What do you do?" And if I say, "I'm a physicist," they make a face like they've eaten a bug. And then they say, "I hated physics." And then they say, "I'm going to go talk to this dentist about root canals." So I usually tell people I'm an astronomer because it's a little bit, "Oh, I love the stars," and then we get to have nice conversations, right? So, it's absolutely something you can have a career in. So I'm a professor, so I get paid to teach. I spend a lot of time in the classroom doing the sort of stuff I'm doing with y'all. My research is funded. I have funding from the National Science Foundation and from NASA, but the university pays me to do research as well. But the research is what drives all the fundamental technology in our modern lives. I work in astrophysics. I think about black holes and general relativity every day. But half of you in this room use general relativity to get here because your smartphone has a piece of technology in it called GPS, which doesn't work without general relativity. The only reason you can navigate to get ice cream with your phone is because someone like me studied general relativity 30 years ago. Right? So the things we do come back to society through the research that we do. And some of us work at Boeing and Motorola and you know places like that, but some of us work in universities. So that's what we do. The big money comes from the tuition you paid to go to college, because most of my money comes from the university. Okay? So the university, the university pays 9 months of my salary, and 3 months of my salary, if I can get a grant, comes from my federal grants. So what do I do at Adler? So at Adler, we have two academic departments. We have a department of astronomy and a department of history and culture of astronomy. So we're like a university department. Our astronomers, we do our research, and we work with our students and our postdocs. But instead of teaching students and giving them homework and quizzes, we do stuff like this. We teach the public. Okay? Now, if you want, I can still give you quizzes and homework. But okay. So no, but we teach the public. We help with exhibits. I do lots of education for government officials, and I go to places like Motorola and Boeing and talk to their employees at lunches and stuff like that. So I do a lot of that. I do a lot of student advising. Yeah, even though I'm at Adler. So okay, let me take two more questions and then we'll call it an evening. Yes, sir. The question is about the big telescopes we're building on Earth compared to telescopes we're building in space. So Hubble, as many of you know, has reached the end of its serviceable life. We no longer can service Hubble. That's not Hubble's problem. That's the space shuttle's problem. We don't have a capability to go service it anymore. Hubble will be deorbited at the end of its life, but it is being replaced, and I'll put replaced in big air quotes. We are flying a new big telescope called the James Webb Space Telescope. It's about, 3 times as large as Hubble, and it will be a bit farther away from Earth, so it in fact will be unserviceable. It should last for about 10 years. James Webb is a telescope which sees light that's in the infrared. So that's light that's just a little bit redder than your eye is capable of seeing. Okay, but it's very good light for looking for the very first stars that formed in the universe, for looking for distant planetary systems, whatever all their science they're going to do is. So it should launch, everyone keep your fingers crossed, in about 2018. It is huge. So it will be folded up. If you go on YouTube, you're watching the Eames video, also Google JWST, James Webb Space Telescope, and you will see a video of it. It's all folded up in the rocket like a piece of origami, and then it has to unfold. Yeah, right? Yeah, but and so, you know, I'm an astrophysicist. I sit in my office all the time, and I do easy things as opposed to making telescopes unfold like flowers in space, okay? But I have absolute faith in my engineering friends at NASA, because they lowered a frickin' rover onto the surface of Mars on a sky crane, okay? And if they can do that, they can make this telescope unfold, right? So I'm confident it'll work. About the end of the decade, that should fly, okay? Now, what's the difference? Well, when you're in space, you can do different stuff. So infrared light is, you can do it from the surface of the Earth, but it's hard because it doesn't like to come through the Earth's atmosphere. Okay, the water and the clouds and the air interfere with infrared light. So it's easier to do infrared from space. You can't do a gigantic infrared telescope on Earth as easily as you can in space. And so Webb will have better views in those situations. But our technology on the ground for telescopes like Giant Magellan, 30-meter telescope, all these telescopes we're talking about building, they're learning how to deal with things like the atmosphere. And so in 25 years, right? Again, I have these bets out with my colleagues as well. In 25 years, what we used to only be able to do with Hubble, we may be able to do from the ground, because controlling mirrors and processing data is getting that much better. So, we'll see. Well, thank you for your attention, everyone. We'll do this again sometime.